right? So sort of the culmination here of the course is Stokes theorem. And I'm hoping I can get enough through stuff that I can do Stokes theorem in general. So Stokes theorem is sort of like my fundamental theorem of calculus, but in higher dimensions. Right? So what I'm going to do today and what I'm going to do next time is generalizations of the fundamental theorem of calculus to higher dimensions. So we have already that if we have, okay, why did I just forget what I'm doing? Well, so the fundamental theorem of calculus says that in one dimension, is just g of, okay, I guess. The end of the The culmination of calculus one. Did I screw it up?
Well, okay.
Whatever variable you want to put here, D, smiley face, of F. Oh, I see, because,
yeah. You just multiply
out X. Yeah, I guess I want DX.
Right. Why can't we just make a D smiley face on the outside?
Yeah, well, let's just do them all smiley face.
Yay! That's
awesome.
Give me a second.
Doesn't matter. Yeah, please.
So, calculus.
Derivative of anything, right? You integrate the derivative, you get back where you started. Yeah, sorry about the y. I was thinking that this was the variable. Okay, so this is the standard fundamental theorem of calculus that says if you integrate the derivative, you might as well just evaluate it at the end. And then there is this generalization to it, which works for gradient vector fields, which tells us, again, we can just evaluate at the ends. But not all vector fields are gradient vector fields. So that's, you know, if all vector fields were gradient vector fields, then there would be no work to do, and everything would be fine. So the goal of these next couple lectures is to increase this to deal with the vector fields that aren't gradient vector fields. And at the end of the last, well, I don't know, in one of the previous classes, I talked about these two quantities called the divergence of a vector field.
It's pretty weird.
Which I hope I will get to this today, which measures, well, okay, so the divergence of the vector field, which is just, so, div f is just the sum of the partials with respect to each component of f, which we can also write as grad dot or del dot f, which, if you know these words, is the trace, I'll write it out, trace of df, and this is also the sum of the eigenvalues f, which is the amount f expands at some point. So this is all evaluated at some point. Right? This is the local expansion rate. So once again, I'm having trouble reading some faces. Okay, good. I read that face easy. Right, so we talked about this before. So this is just telling us how much F spreads stuff out or squishes it up or doesn't. I'm going to save that for a bit. But this is a useful... So, I guess there's an N in the mail. So, for example, let me talk about this a little more. Suppose instead of having some open curve gamma, I have a closed curve gamma. So gamma starts and ends at the same place. And I have stuff flowing through. Well, maybe I want to know how much stuff is stretched out or not. So this is called the flux over this space, and let's take an extreme example where stuff is created in here. Then certainly you would expect there to be divergence here. stuff spreads out. And so this is a quantity that we want to know about. Okay, so this is not what I'm going to talk about yet. So we talked about this a little bit, was it last time? Or the time before that, or sometime, I don't know, before I ate too much food. So this is something we want to know about, but I'm going to save that a little bit. So this is related to something called Gauss's theorem. Tells us about this, which I'm going to try to get to at the end. And another quantity that we talked about was the curl of the vector field, which instead of this quantity was, well, let me first do it in the plane, was this thing, this mysterious del cross F, which measures the circulation of the vector field. Yeah. And so I want to sort of put that on hold a little bit. What did I say there? Okay, so I'm going to, and so in the plane, so mostly today I'm just going to talk about the functions, a vector field in the plane. And I want to try and maybe motivate a little bit why the curl here, which in the plane is this quantity, so F of x, y, will have two components, p of x, y, q of x, y. Right, so I have a vector field in the x direction and a vector field in the y direction, I mean, something that describes how f varies in both x and y independently. Yeah. And so in this case, the curl or the planar curl, I didn't want to write it uppercase, but I did. The curl of F is going to be the partial of Q with respect to X minus the partial of P with respect to Y. So if F is gradient, if F is a gradient flow, and it's continuously differentiable. Right? Because the mixed partials will be equal. So let's just write it this way. Gxy is right, because that's what this is. This is the difference of the mixed partials. So if we have a gradient flow, then there is no curl. But if we don't have a gradient vector field, then this measures something. And let's think about what it measures. So if I, and again, I'm going to think about closed paths. So we know that if we have a gradient vector field, and I'm just going to draw a picture. I have some gamma here, and I have my vector field doing its thing, whatever, we have these arrows, then if I compute, so I'm going to start at some point, how about here? This will be gamma of 0 is gamma of 1, because I start here and I go around this way. I've got too many arrows. Hold on, doesn't matter. I start here, I go around my curve, and I come back. Then if I integrate f dot dx over gamma, well, I should get 0. Because this is g of gamma of 1 minus g of gamma of 0, which is just, these are the same. Right?
Yep.
No.
Okay. So nothing going on yet.
So if I integrate the gradient vector field over some curve like this, I get nothing interesting. But if it isn't a gradient vector field, then I might get something interesting. And so remember, this measures in some sense the amount of work, if you want, the effect of the vector field as I cruise around this path. And so if I don't have a, if F isn't a gradient vector field, so there is not a conserved quantity, then I would expect this to be non-zero. And this sort of measures, I don't know, the twistiness. So then I might have this over a closed curve gamma. And in fact, there's some notation that I guess I will start using. If you put a little circle here, this means that gamma is a closed curve. So doing this, so over some curve gamma, so gamma is closed, which can be anyway, and it's counterclockwise, and it has an orientation, as a counterclockwise. And those line integrals are the same, but here I must have gamma of 0 equals gamma of 1, or whatever my beginning has to equal my end. Also notice that in this case, it matters which way I go. Well, let me finish this. So I might have that. Right? In other words, well, go ahead. Right. So let me just point that out. So suppose that this, I guess it doesn't matter. And then I don't know even how to write it. Negative gamma? in the same way, so this isn't so wacky. I mean, if you think about it, well, let's do one where it's obviously true. So I'm just going to do it by picture. I can write it down because I'm probably going to screw it up. Let's, the vector field is there. That vector field. So that is the one that just corresponds to going around a circle. What is that? That is y and negative x. No, x and negative y, x. Right?
Yeah.
So let's think about negative y, and let's normalize it. X. So that vector field. And then if I just take the circle, the unit circle, then this vector field is, so this is cosine t sine t. This vector field is tangent here everywhere. So integrating over the unit circle, integrating over gamma of f dx, well, the vector field is 1, right? And so that's just adding up 1 as you go around the unit circle. So this is 2 pi, without even any calculating. If you want to parameterize it, take the derivative, you'll still get 2 pi. But just by thinking, I'm taking the unit vector and dragging it all the way around and asking how much did it turn? Well, it turned 2 pi. So nothing changed. But if I go the other way, if I take, let's call it alpha, really it should be fish. L, yeah. So if I take the curly L to be the other way, which is the same as cosine t, negative sine t. So that is, instead of going this way, I'm going to go around this way around the circle. Then I'm going to add up negative 1 as I go around. Right? Because the tangent vector here goes the other way from the vector field. So that integral over the upside down gamma has to be negative. Yeah.
Is gradient and non-gradient, is that the same as saying conservative and non-conservative?
Yeah, same. So there's not a conserved quantum. Right, so this guy doesn't correspond to any, it's not possible to have rotation around the origin being the gradient of some function. Right? We did that already. And so, okay, so what, this is what I'm trying to say. If we go backwards around the half, then we change the sign to the other sign. And this is exactly the same, the exact analogy here, is that for one variable, we integrate from a to b of f of x dx. This is negative the integral from b to a. It's exactly the same thing if you're should I prove this?
Don't you need to switch the direction that you're traveling the curve?
This is the vector field.
No, I mean the line integral.
This is switching the direction.
Yeah, but you're not reflecting that in. Well,
you're saying it by saying it's negative.
Okay, so instead of writing negative gamma, I'll write the upside down gamma. There. That's the curve that goes the other way.
Yeah, I know, but in the integral where you have the loop, you have it going counterclockwise. Both
they always go. They always go counterclockwise.
Isn't that the direction that the loop is going? Isn't that the direction of the curve? So if you make the curve negative, then no.
Here, I'll take the arrow off.
That works.
There you go. Now we're
gonna stay on there. So the reason that the arrow is put on there, so that if I have a curve, if my curve is not an oriented curve, but just the words unit circle,
okay,
then this means go counterclockwise.
Okay.
So usually, you'll see it sometimes without an arrow and sometimes with an arrow. Let me write it without an arrow to mean it is a closed curve. Or in fact, just whatever the hell we were doing before, it's a line integral, and it just happens to be a closed curve. If you go the wrong way, you change the sign. That's the statement I'm trying to make is if you go the wrong way, you change the sign. And that's really easy to prove, because here, I mean, I did this example by no calculation, but if we do it by calculation, I make the substitution r equals negative t, then my derivative is negative of my other derivative. The derivative pulls through the integral. There it is. I've changed the sign. So without writing it down, that's the proof. So in general, whenever we have a line integral and we go the wrong way, we get a negative of that. Okay. So I was still trying to motivate why we're looking at curl. And I've lost track of where I am in my motivation here. At least in this example, this is somehow measuring how much this vector field twists around. And it seems reasonable, even without thinking about anything, that this quantity is something like, I want to apologize up front for being very hand-wavy here. If you want to read a more careful thing, I'll just read the book. I want to give you some idea of what's going on, which you may not get from the book, but what is this measuring? This is, in some sense, a measurement of how far from gradient f is. Because this would be zero when f is a gradient field. And this is measuring sort of how far away it is from being a gradient. It's also, you can think of it in terms of physics, as measuring sort of how much work it is to go around this path. So blah 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 blah. Okay, so let me tell you Green's theorem. Let me leave this here for a minute. Because Green's theorem is, in some sense, this thing cranked up. Right, so Green's theorem is Stokes' theorem in the plane. So, okay, let me put on hold for a minute. There are three important theorems that I'm going to try and cover today. Not today, this week. There's Green's theorem, the divergence theorem, which is also called Gauss's theorem. Too many S's, I'll just call it the Gauss theorem. And then there's Stokes' theorem. And in some sense, they are all the fundamental theorem of calculus. So their friend is the fundamental theorem of calculus. And a lot of times, once you get, these look like three different theorems, but they're really all the same theorem. They look like four different theorems. But they're really sort of go by the name of Stokes' theorem. And it's and roughly they say, let's see, if I have, so let me say it not as a thing. I have some region and I don't care how many dimensions we're in. So maybe this is a spherical object, maybe this is a 47-dimensional object, whatever it is. It says that, so this is a rough idea. If I integrate, so I have some blob in some number of dimensions. Right, this is a blob. It's a high-dimensional blobby thing. And it says roughly that I can calculate the integral I can calculate the integral of some function on the inside. No, backwards. Interior. This is probably, I'm going to screw this up, right? No, sorry. Okay, so let's say it's a derivative. By instead computing the integral, whatever this means, of f on the bound. This is what the fundamental theorem of calculus says, right? If I didn't tell you what any of these theorems say, but I'm sort of telling you morally what they say. So I have to make sense of what I mean by that and what I mean by this. And it changes depending on which of these theorems we're talking about. But the fundamental theorem of calculus says that if I want to integrate some function here from a to b, well, I find an antiderivative so where g prime of x is f. Right, that's the fundamental theorem of calculus. Where, so I want to compute the integral of a thing on the inside, and instead I find some other function that is an antiderivative, and I just compute it on the edges. Here, there are two edges. So I'm really, my blobby thing here looks like this. It's that line. And so the edges of this are here and here. So I can push the integration on the inside to what happens on the two ends, and then everything's great. So these sort of all collectively go by the name of, this is sort of a content-free version of Stokes' theorem. Well, I don't know if it's content-free, but a very squishy version of Stokes' theorem says that knowing a function on the boundary, knowing an antiderivative, whatever the heck that means, on the boundary tells me the integral of the function on the inside. Now I've lost track. Okay, so Green's theorem says, and let me just write it carefully. So, suppose that So I have some A, so let A be a bounded subset of the plane. So I need an edge on it. I can't have it stretching off to infinity. If I want to let it stretch off to infinity, then I have a problem. And I need a little technical condition. Let's say it's a finite union, I guess I have to say what this means, of simple pieces. I'll say what that means in a second. So, in other words, it only has a finite number of holes in it. Let me say this squishily. And the boundary of A is some curve gamma, which is piecewise smooth. In other words, it doesn't have too many corners. The corners don't pile up. So it's not a fractal. So in terms of a picture, this is just saying A looks something, we can put a few corners in it if you want. Like that. Right? It can have corners, it can have straight parts, that's all okay. But it's only got finitely many holes in it. So that this condition means that I can break it up into chunks that don't have holes if I want to. I don't need to. So I can break it up into chunks that don't have holes in it. And the boundary isn't too nasty. So the boundary doesn't. So doesn't have a sequence of holes in it like that, and it doesn't have really squiggly bits like that. There are plenty of things that, so, anyway. So, yeah. All right? Don't worry about it if you don't understand what I'm talking about. Okay, so now also suppose that I have this function f, which gives me my vector field, is continuously differentiable a, so its partials are equal. Actually, no, that's not what I want. I want p and q to be continuously differentiable. So f of x, y is p, q, and those guys are good. P, q, continuously differentiable. So p and q are nice-ish. They have mixed partials that are equal. And I already wrote gamma. Did I write what gamma is? The boundary of A is this curve gamma. So in this case, gamma consists of these three pieces. Let's call this gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3. And so I also need to orient gamma. Which way is right? So that A is on its left. That means that if I go around, let's do the simple case, A is inside. So if I go counterclockwise, A is inside. So that means in this case where I have three holes, or how about two holes? I'm sorry I'm stating Green's theorem in such a long way, but so if I have this case, then gamma needs to be oriented that way. Right, if you walk along gamma, then A is always on your left. Here, when I walk on gamma, A is on the left. Yeah? No? So gamma goes this way here, goes counterclockwise here, and here, when I go this way, I want to keep it on my left, so it goes the other way here. The inside guys go the wrong way. So this says inside goes clockwise and the outside. So in the usual case like this, we just go counterclockwise. But if there's holes, we gotta go clockwise. Okay, I'm almost ready to state the result. So with all that crap, it says that if I want to integrate, let me state it backwards. If I want to integrate some kind of a derivative, so if I want to integrate the curl,
or is it the other way?
Which is the partial of q with respect to y minus the partial of p with respect to x. Dx dy. Then this is the same integrating over gamma dx plus q dy, which is the same as saying f dot dx integrated. Okay, so this says that integrating f over the boundary is the same as integrating some kind of derivative over the inside. Yeah.
And what you said over there with the donut.
Well, it's not really a donut. It's supposed to be an annulus. I think. But okay. I mean, a donut is.
Wouldn't have a third dimension. Okay.
Yeah.
Good, you're there. If you're going to do this and the area A has holes, you must do all of the interior boundaries as well.
Right. So in this case, if I call this gamma 1 and this gamma 2, then I would have to integrate gamma 1, let's do f dot dx, plus gamma 2 of f dot dx, where gamma 2 goes the other way. Right? So this integral over gamma means over all the bits of gamma. But each bit has to be a closed curve. Because if I don't have a closed curve, then A will spill into the hole. So. And that also means that if you think about it for a second, if I do something silly, oops, so imagine that my region has a slit like that, then my curve gamma really has to go here and back. So gamma is both. It has to be closed. So in order to get a slit, I cover it both times. In other words, it doesn't matter. Right? Yeah?
Instead of, if you have it go the same way on the inside, and you just do minus the integral, does it work like that, or you can still take out the negative sign if you switch?
So when I want to do this, right, if I want to orient gamma the other way, then I would put a minus sign.
I feel like that's more intuitive, because they can just subtract in the holes instead of
Yeah, if you want to think of it, I mean, so that's you sort of why it works.
Yeah.
So it's just that you may not be able to integrate in the middle. The function might not be defined here. So it's a little hard to subtract from holes if there's no. So imagine that your function blows up here. Imagine that my vector field is really nasty in the middle. I can't even define it.
Yes.
Then it'd be hard to subtract oriented the other way. Yeah. I mean,
there is a reason why
reverse the director. Well, I mean, so like if you think about this guy has a problem at the origin, right? This vector field has a problem at the origin. And so if I want to integrate over a circle containing the origin, I don't even know what that means.
But with all of this stuff, you're integrating a weird plot.
Yeah.
So can you just subtract the area, the volume, or whatever, of the holes?
Well, so notice that what I'm integrating is not,
I'm not calculating the volume, I'm calculating the curl.
Right, this is a line integral.
Oh,
right?
So you're still doing the
it's a vector field. Everything here is a vector field.
Okay.
Right?
I thought you were just integrating.
No. This is a vector field. So this is a volume. Right? I mean, if you want, this is a volume.
Yeah, it's like the total force or whatever.
Right, exactly. It's sort of the volume of force or something. So this is a regular double integral. Right? So this sort of says a double integral. So this is a double integral over the inside is a kind of a single integral over the boundary.
And
that's sort of the analogy here with the here. I'm going to have a double integral to double integrate. My single integral is a zero integral. So I drop a dimension, or I raise a dimension. If I want to calculate this, I could integrate and raise a dimension of something simpler.
Yeah.
Okay. Right, so this. So just as an aside, it's very common in, say, topology and so on. So this symbol means derivative, or this symbol means a kind of a derivative, and it's very common in topology that if I want to take the boundary of a shape, let's say a field in a circle, that's not field, that's a circle. And so it's very common in topology to use this symbol to mean boundary, which is the same, it's not an accident that we use the same symbol for boundary as we do for derivative. And it's precisely because of Stokes' theorem relates the boundary, the geometric or topological edge thing, to a derivative on the inside. And there's all sorts of cool duality between this sort of geometric operation of passing to the edge and this sort of analytic operation of taking a derivative. Okay? So we won't talk about that.
So conceptually, what measure? What are you measuring if you integrate the curl? Is kind of collection of forces.
You're measuring the. So, of course, not being a physicist, I'm probably going to screw it up. But you're measuring the circulation around here. You're measuring sort of, you know, if I have my vector field, let's say my vector field looks like this, but it's not conservative. So there's something funny going on in here. And I want to measure how hard is it to take a a particle or a thing and drag it around this curve. Well, that's going to depend on sort of how much this thing wants to twist. Although it's not really twisting. And that's what this is measuring. It's measuring the sort of the total difference from being gradient. How much work it is to do that. And so here, in this case, where it's really clearly twisting, then going around here, I guess somewhere I'm off by one. Maybe that's negative 2 pi and that's plus 2 pi. I did something wrong because I have a sign wrong. But going around here, you know, let's go this way, is work. Because all the way I'm against the wind. And so this is measuring sort of the circulation, or the current, or all of that stuff. Yeah, I just blew the whole class. Oh well. All right, that's okay. So this, yeah.
So we this is back to A. It's not like A is out of
A. Area isn't, so this will be a double integral. Right, you calculate these things. Right? If I have, maybe I should like do an example rather than, let's do that example. So here, my P is minus Y. My Q, let's just do that. Let's just do let's just do this. P of xy is this, Q of xy, that, right? My vector field is this vector field. And so now I want to compute gamma is the unit circle. Cosine t, sine t, t goes from 0 to 2 pi, and if I want to compute p dx plus q dy, so this is a line integral, so that is the line integral x, no, minus y dx plus x dy, that's what I want to compute over the unit circle. So if I want to do this, then I parameterize gamma as, say, cosine t, sine t. So I can just do this directly. Integrate from 0 to 2 pi. Y is minus sine t. Dx is cosine t dt. Plus 0 to 2 pi x. Am I doing this okay? People follow what I'm doing? Okay. X is, I've lost it, cosine t dy is sine t dt. So that's the integral I want to compute. Integral from 0 to 2 pi. Crap, it's 0. Something is wrong. Did I take a derivative wrong?
Yeah, dx. Should have signed this one.
Yeah. Okay, I did something wrong.
Yeah, can you, your parameter of
Yeah.
And this is
better. That's what I get for trying to do it fast.
And then you're gonna get to.
And so this is integral from 0 to 2 pi of sine squared plus cosine squared dt, which is 2 pi. Okay. So that's one statement. Just calculating this integral. Somebody asked me this. Somewhere over here, somebody asked me, and I started doing it. Now I forgot who asked me. You did. Okay. But by Green's theorem, that also says that this is the integral over the unit disk of, well, the partial of P, the partial of Q with respect to Y is Q is X. All right. What did I do wrong here? E cubed? Oh. Right, it's the mixed part.
Q and X.
That's Q. That's X.
Good.
Well, it's because the pieces.
Sorry, I wrote it down wrong in the beginning. It's the mix. It's the difference of the mixed partials. If I view this as great. So, derivative of Q with respect to X. With respect to X, 1, and the derivative of P with respect to Y is minus 1, and so this integral over the unit disk of 2 dx dy, right? Yes? No? Well, that's easy. I want to integrate, so this is, if you like, a double integral, I'm not even going to write it out, over the unit disk of 2 dx dy, but it's a lot easier to think. I take the disk of radius 1, and I erect a function of height 2 over it, and I ask for the volume of that cylinder. Volume of that cylinder, well, the base has radius pi, has the area is pi r squared, the height is 2, so this is 2 pi. So Green's theorem tells me that I can do this either way. Okay. All right. I want to at least justify why this makes any sense and not just do an example. The example I was going to do, but I didn't, would be to take this one. So let me just say, this one is done in the book, so I won't do it, because I'm going to run out of time. Take this one, let me just say some words about that one, which is the same as this one, except that it has a problem at the origin. So if I take this one, and I want to integrate this nasty vector field over some ellipse or something, then when you parameterize it and try and do this integral, it really sucks. You don't want to do that. But if you check, then this quantity, it comes out to be if I change this to a circle, nothing. This quantity doesn't change. And so I can just integrate it over the circle. If I just check. So. All right, I'm not going to do that example. Let me prove Green's theorem before I run out of time. So why does Green's theorem work? Just because it does. Okay, good. We're happy with that?
Yeah.
No, so Green's theorem is really just the fundamental theorem of calculus. Because if we look at this quantity, P dx and Q dy, so Green's theorem says what? I don't know, I've screwed it up. So in the case where the region A is simple. Okay, so I'm going to say that A looks something like I don't know, something like a fish.
Okay.
It can look like a fish. So A is a fish.
It can't be a fish.
Goldfish, you have to eat it.
What's green? It's
a green goldfish. You don't want to eat the golden yellow. I mean, you know, the little orange crackers. So let's say A looks like that. And we want to compute, well, let's just break it up into two pieces. So I want to compute the integral over my curve gamma of f dx, which is the integral over my curve gamma of p dx plus q dy. And I can break this up into the integral over my curve gamma of p dx plus the integral over my curve gamma of q dy. You can certainly do that. Again, it just means things like this. Yeah? And now, what does that really mean? So I want to look at my fishy curve here. And notice that if I'm just looking at this piece, let me write in some variables. I'm looking at something like that. So I'm going to parameterize this curve gamma, which goes this way. And I'm going to notice that in x, it goes from A to B. And I can write gamma as, well, it's this. If I start here, let's start here. I go along for a while until I get to here. So there's some curve, let's call it V of X. So let's break it into three pieces in this picture. Here is gamma 1 on the bottom, that way. Here is gamma 2 on the top, and here's gamma 3. Okay, so I'm going to break it into three pieces. If you have a more complicated thing, you can break it into more pieces, and if it's simpler, you can break it into less. But break it up into pieces where it's graphs of functions, or it's vertical. So more formally, right, you break it into pieces where it's graphs of functions or it's vertical. Well, notice that if I integrate over gamma 3, x, this is 0, because this will be 0. That is, if I parameterize gamma 3, I get a curve whose derivative is 0 in the x direction. So I can ignore this part. Right? And on gamma 1, let's write gamma 1 as some curve. It's a graph of a function, so it's the curve x. Let's call this V of x, or bottom, if you have trouble distinguishing B's and B's, bottom. Right, gamma 1, I can parameterize it as the graph of x, some function V of x, so it's a curve like that. So here, x goes from A to B. Is that clear? Those of you that are, yeah. And on M2, I have x, u of x, but x goes the wrong way. X goes from A back to B. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So now, I guess I'll just start moving this way so I can keep pointing at that same picture. So now let's just calculate what the integral over gamma, let's do, say, gamma 1 of p of xy dx. Well, this is the integral from a to b of p of x, v of x,
gamma
2.
Gamma 1 prime.
I forgot, sorry. This dx here, remember, is gamma prime dt. Right, I have to adjust by the derivative. Right? Yes? No?
Yeah, wait.
But it's really gamma 1 prime. The dx for gamma is whatever speed gamma is traversing this curve in the x direction. But since I parameterized it by x, dx is just dx. If I do the change of variables, then it comes out that I don't have to adjust anything here. Because dx is just dx, I parameterize this in unit speed in the x direction. Is everybody okay with that?
Wait, is it derivative of gamma prime in the first part?
Okay, so here. Let's write it correctly first. Forget about all of that junk. This is integral from 0 to 1 of p, or maybe 1 half, I don't care, p of gamma 1 of t, gamma 2 of t, and then dx is gamma 1 prime of t dt. Yeah?
That's equal to pxy dx?
Sure. Because this is x, this is y, and this is dx.
Oh, that's gamma 1.
Yeah, gamma 1.
Okay.
Gamma 1. It's okay. Just the x part of gamma. Right? It's not a vector. It's just the x component of the vector. But if I... Okay, I sort of screwed up my notation because I'm using gamma 1 and gamma 2 in two different ways here.
Yeah.
Okay, so no.
Thank you.
Sorry. This means, how about gamma x, gamma y, gamma x? How about that?
Thank you.
Yep. Sorry for messing up my notation. Okay, so if we parameterize the curve and we want to calculate this over the first curve, then we can do that. But if I choose my parameterization like this, then gamma x prime of t dt is just dx with this x. So this is the same thing. Is that right? It is just a regular integral in one variable. And if I do the other guy, so I take the other piece where I parameterize the top half of the fish by gamma 2. So if I integrate over gamma 2, I get a similar thing, but it goes from B to A. Right? So I parameterize the bottom, it's the graph of some curve V of X, and I parameterize the top, and it goes from B to A, so it's backwards. So this is the integral from negative the integral from A to B of P of X U of X dx. Yeah? And so what I want, and I already showed that the integral over gamma 3 of p dx is 0, so I don't have to worry about that one. Almost there. Okay, sorry, I went. And so now we put them together. So my integral over gamma of p dx is going to be these two things added together. The integral from a to b of p of x, v of x minus the dx. Integral from a to b of p of x, u of x, dx, which is the same, just integrate from a to b, p of x, the bottom, minus p of x, u of x, the whole thing, dx. And now comes the magic observation that all of this junk, it's just a function of x. So we can really do the fundamental theorem of calculus here to throw in a y and not change anything. That is, I can think of this mess, so I can think of, so let me put it an intermediate step here. If I integrate, what do I want? V minus u, so that means v has to be on top, and u has to be on the bottom, p of x. So if I do a silly thing, I do the fundamental theorem of calculus the wrong way. If I have the derivative of a thing integrated, so I've changed variables to y, then that's the same as p of v. Well, didn't leave enough room. Minus p of x, u of x. Yeah? No? So, I mean, this is like magic. Well, it's not magic. You just see this, you say, yeah, sure. The thing, you know,
yeah,
that makes this a theorem is you say, oh, geez, I can do that. Cool. So it just seems like magic. Well, that's where this partial business comes from. So this, I want to flip it around. So that's equal to negative. I can put the u on top because I like the top to be on top and the bottom to be on the bottom. The partial dp dy, let me leave out the variables. Let me not. I have a dy. Let me leave out this part of the variable. That's the inside of this integral. So that is, that means that this equals negative integral from a to b, integral from u to b. I didn't leave enough room. Crap. I'll write it over here. That this equals negative the integral from a to b, negative the integral from u, from v to u, of the partial of p with respect to y, dy, dx. Because this inside, this bit, is that bit. Well, what is this? This is the, there's a negative sign here. This is exactly, don't tell me I erased Green's theorem. This is exactly the first term, or the second term, in Green's theorem. Now do the same thing, laying on your side and looking at this region the other way. And if you check the negative sign, you don't get a negative sign, because the top is still the top. And so then you get Green's theorem. And I guess I didn't get anywhere near where I wanted to get, but maybe that's where I should stop. So we get this part, and so that means that we have that if I do the double integral over the whole thing of dq dy minus dp dx, yeah. The mixed partials, dy dx, and that's the same as the integral gamma of f dot d. Okay. So next time I will try in some way
right here
to move this up the dimension. Well, to do the divergence theorem and then I probably won't.
I'll definitely take a look at that because.
So I guess one other statement. Green's theorem is sometimes called Stokes' theorem in the plane.